This is Carrie Ballinger, and welcome to Teradata TechBytes. I'd like to spend the next few minutes with you talking about the Teradata Integrated Workload Management offering. This is your basic bundling of workload management. So let's get started looking at the basic pieces of the Teradata Integrated Workload Management offering. The most important component in Teradata workload management is the workload itself. And this workload represents one of the several different types of work that's going to be running on the platform. You'll probably define many workloads on your system. There could be anywhere from 6 to 8 to 10 to 12 or more. When a query enters a Teradata system, it goes through the parsing and the optimizing and the optimizer, and when it's ready to execute in the AMPs, the workload management software knows what the query characteristics are because it can see the query plan. It also knows information from the session logon, such as the user ID or the account or the profile. This information is used to map that query to one of the existing workloads that has been defined in the system. And that mapping of a query to a workload is done by means of classification criteria. And classification criteria applies not only to the workloads, but also to some of the optional components in Teradata Integrated Workload Management, such as the filters and the throttles. We're going to talk about all these components in a little bit, but the main point I want to make on classification criteria is that you have a lot of choices. These are the three main groupings of classification criteria in Teradata Workload Management. We've got what I call WHO criteria, which is the information that's known at session logon time, like the user, or even the IP address that the session is originating from. And then we have WHERE criteria, which is the database objects that this particular query is going to be touching or operating on. Things like views, databases, even stored procedures. And one of the new type of WHERE criteria is the query grid server. You can, for example, if you're accessing a foreign server, you can use the name of that foreign server as classification criteria for a workload. And then any query that enters a system that will be accessing that particular foreign server can map to a single workload or a single system throttle, for example. The third classification criteria is the WHAT criteria, and this is basically your query characteristics, things like whether it's an all-AMP request or not, whether there's DDL going on, or if it's a collect statistics statement. And one of the most popular of these WHAT criteria is estimated processing time, which is used by many Teradata sites today as a way to classify shorter queries to one workload, usually at a higher priority, and then longer queries to a different workload. The system filter rule is an option. This is not widely used, and it's not widely used because it can be harsh at times. It's a pass-fail type of rule. Any query entering the system that matches the classification of a filter rule will be rejected, will not be allowed to start running. In this example, on this slide, we've got a filter rule that says no table scans on the call detail record table between the hours of 8 in the morning and 5 at night. So any query that comes into the system, if this rule is active, that attempts to do a full table scan on the CDR table will be rejected. This could be useful if you want to make sure that only indexed access or partition elimination type activity happens against a really large table. This is reported back in DBQL as well as the workload management logs, so the DBA knows how many of these rejections are taking place, and the end user gets a message back saying what the system filter rule was that he or she violated. You can also put system filters in warning mode which means the queries are checked against the criteria that's in the rule, but never rejected. They're simply reported as being in violation of the rule. So that's actually a good way of finding out who's issuing these queries and maybe talking to them before you actually reject their queries. And the second option I wanted to mention is the system throttle. Throttles in Teradata Workload Management are one of the more popular options, and these are concurrency control options. The system throttle comes with classification criteria that the administrator decides, and any query entering the system that matches to that classification criteria will be controlled by that system throttle. When you define a throttle, you specify a limit, which is the concurrency limit. When a query enters the system that matches the classification of that throttle rule, the counter that's being kept in the database will be compared to the limit that's defined in the rule. And if the counter of queries that are under the control of that throttle rule is equal to the limit, then that query is, under normal circumstances, placed in a delay queue, which is first in, first out. The queries could be rejected. You have the option with a throttle to either delay or reject. But to be honest with you, I've never seen anyone use a reject option on a throttle rule. So for most cases, you can assume that when the counter is at the limit, any new queries will go into that delay queue. There are several different types of throttles available in Teradata Integrated Workload Management. We just talked about the system throttle. There's also utility throttles that function in a similar way, but they're exclusively for the load and the fast export type of utilities. We also have workload throttles. They do not come with classification criteria because they are attached to a workload itself. And the workload has classification criteria. So if you add a throttle to a workload, then any query classifying to that workload will be managed by that throttle. One of the new options in terms of throttles is the group throttle, which is a higher level throttle above multiple workload throttles. And it provides a limit that takes into account several different workload throttles. And that limit may be less than the total combined workload throttles, as I'm showing you here in this diagram. One of the new features is the ability to prioritize the delay queue. What prioritizing the delay queue does is it sorts the entries, all the queries that are waiting to run that have been placed in the delay queue. It orders them by their priority scheduler priority so that the higher priority requests are always guaranteed to be released from the delay queue ahead of any lower priority requests. And as this example shows you, the default is the traditional first in, first out ordering, where the query that arrives at 9 o'clock may be a low priority query, but it's first to arrive, it's going to be first to be released when it's able to run. With the option of prioritizing the delay queue, the highest priority, no matter what time it arrived, is going to be the first query to be released if its particular throttle's counter is below that throttle's limit. So you have to be a candidate to be released in addition to being the highest priority among those that are releasable at that point in time.